This video was sponsored by Dashlane. Click the link in the description to get a free 30-day trial of Dashlane Premium. On a single night in January last year, thousands of volunteers in 3,000 cities and counties in the United States counted the number of people living in emergency shelters, transitional housing, and out on the streets. This snapshot of the homeless in the U.S. is critical to understanding the scope of the crisis. The 2019 count showed that 567,715 people were homeless across the country, an increase of 2.7% from the year before. Here in California, the number of homeless people jumped 16.4%. 1 in 4 homeless people in the U.S. live in California, a state with notoriously high housing prices and an aversion to building affordable housing. How can cities in California and across the United States address this growing crisis? Are there strategies cities can use to reduce the amount of people who become homeless and help those who already are homeless find homes faster? The answer is yes, but it depends on what strategy you use and how you fund the solution. So what do we mean by the term homelessness exactly? What does that term mean? The U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development defines homelessness as an individual or family who lacks a fixed, regular, and adequate nighttime residence. They consider someone homeless if they live in their cars, a bus shelter, or campground. They also consider someone homeless if they're in a shelter or transitional housing program. You need to have a true, regular place to live to not be homeless. And before we dive into the solutions to homelessness, we need to understand the problem. There are lots of misconceptions out there. For example, a big one is that all homeless people are dealing with substance abuse issues or having a mental health crisis. And this simply isn't the case. Homeless people come from all walks of life. It is true that people in vulnerable groups and marginalized groups are disproportionately represented in the homeless population. Racial minorities, LGBTQ people, single mothers, and veterans are all more likely to be homeless than other groups. A useful way of thinking about the homeless population, at least for the short duration of this video, is to separate them into two groups: short-term homeless people and chronic homeless people. There are lots of ways to define chronic homelessness, but basically it's someone who's been homeless for a year or several times in a 3-year span, and may also be experiencing a disability, a mental health crisis, a substance abuse issue, or some other barrier to employment or finding housing. Chronically homeless individuals are probably more visible than short-term homeless people, and are the people who come to mind when thinking about the topic. But only about 1 in 5 homeless people are chronically homeless at any given time. Of concern is the fact that this share has been increasing in recent years. Being homeless is terrible for a person's physical and mental health, so reducing the amount of time someone is homeless is critical and a big focus of government agencies and nonprofits tackling the issue. More commonly, however, is that people are homeless for a relatively short period of time, or at least shorter than the chronically homeless. The average length of stay at an emergency shelter in the U.S. was 69 days for single men, 51 days for single women, and 70 days for families. This is important because we tend to attach homelessness to somebody like it's part of their identity and filled with stigma. But in reality, it's a temporary state, not a personality trait or something like that. People experience it and then move on. In fact, many homeless people rehouse themselves without the aid of emergency shelters, transitional housing, or other programs meant to help homeless people. So that brings us to solution time. If many people can find adequate housing after a relatively brief period of homelessness, then it seems like it wouldn't be that hard to house everybody else. But the chronically homeless can be difficult to rehouse. So how can cities do it? It depends on how you frame the problem of homelessness. There are two ways urban leaders typically define this problem. Number one, you could see it as a crisis facing vulnerable people in need of help. Solutions would emphasize finding treatment for substance abuse and mental health issues, ensuring people have adequate housing, reducing the amount of time people are homeless, and preventing people from becoming homeless in the first place. Number two, you could see homelessness as a human blight on our cities. Solutions would emphasize removing homeless people from public view, cleaning up the streets, and minimizing any littering or vandalism. Treatment and housing are certainly one way of doing this, but the primary concern is getting homeless people out of sight. This is how some business owners see the problem when a homeless person sleeps under one of their awnings. They would love to see that person get help, but they really just want that person gone and fast. One approach treats homeless people as, well, people, while the other treats them as a nuisance. Let's talk about the ways cities have been successful at achieving their goals for each of these strategies. The primary way homeless advocates, nonprofits serving the homeless, and government agencies approach homelessness is using a housing first strategy. The premise behind housing first is just what it says. Try to get people in housing as soon as possible. This means off the streets and out of the emergency shelter and into some kind of transitional or supportive housing arrangement. This is in contrast to the previous model of treatment first. Treatment First withholds housing assistance until a person is free of substance abuse issues, and sometimes until they are actually employed. There have been many studies that show Housing First is more effective. It's much easier to get clean and get a job with a roof over your head. One great example of Housing First comes from Finland. The country's NGOs with state support have been aggressive about renting, purchasing, and building apartments for its homeless people and allowing them to move in without any preconditions. They provide counselors to help new residents find social services. Residents must pay rent, but with a stable address, it's easier to find a job. Finland's Housing First approach means that most people are housed in these apartments, and the remainder can find beds in the emergency shelters. Nobody has to sleep outside. For non-chronic homeless people, the best way to reduce homelessness is to have them not become homeless in the first place. Prevention is the strategy here. But how do you prevent homelessness? It can be difficult, but it helps to understand why people become homeless. Many people become homeless after a family breakup. Domestic violence is a key example here. Integrating domestic violence support networks with homelessness support networks means that somebody can find housing before becoming homeless first. Eviction is another common reason people become homeless. People might lose their job and can't pay rent. Many find work again, but that gap is enough time for them to fall behind on their rent and get evicted. Some homeless nonprofits offer one-time grants to get people through that momentary hard time. This grant is an excellent use of money because it costs government agencies and nonprofits much less than letting that person become homeless and providing all of the other services needed to help them find a new home. One of the most important ways to prevent homelessness is for cities to encourage the construction of more affordable housing. With the federal government no longer building affordable housing and single-room occupancy apartments on the decline, there are fewer units affordable to very low-income individuals, particularly people bouncing back from a period of homelessness. This is why homelessness is particularly acute in California, a state in the midst of a housing affordability crisis affecting even the middle class. Homelessness is a crisis with many facets, but the most important is housing. I want to circle back and talk about solution number 2, removing homeless people from view. This is not a solution I advocate for, as it's basically sweeping the problem under the rug. But many local governments view the problem in this way and use a variety of techniques to clean up the streets. You'll often see new park benches with armrests in the middle to make it more difficult for homeless people to sleep there. Cities often make it illegal to panhandle or sleep in public. The city of Sarasota, Florida, paid for bus tickets to ship their homeless people out of town entirely. When these clean-up-the-street cities do build a shelter, they use a model pioneered in San Antonio that has been replicated in other cities. San Antonio's shelter is called Haven for Hope, a massive 23-acre complex its operators refer to as a transformational campus. Unlike most shelters, it is open 24 hours a day. It's huge and can accommodate many people, but it's not a housing-first campus. Its operators, the city, and cities with similar shelters believe support services are coddling homeless people and not solving the problem. At Haven for Hope and Safe Harbor, a similar shelter in St. Petersburg, Florida, many people sleep outside the shelter and are not let in until they are sober. At Haven for Hope, 750 people sleep in an outdoor courtyard designed for 400. If you break the rules over at Safe Harbor, which could mean something as simple as being disrespectful to staff or failing to clean up after yourself, you could be sent to sleep outside. One of the main reasons shelters like Haven for Hope and Safe Harbor are open during the day is so that homeless people stay there and don't linger downtown. In San Antonio, the number of homeless people downtown has dropped from 800 in 2010 to about 100 now. St. Petersburg has seen a 90% drop in street homeless people. But these shelters aren't any better at reducing homelessness. Remember, people in emergency shelters like Haven for Hope are still considered homeless. Safe Harbor, in particular, has a dismal record of moving people into permanent housing. These shelters are generally good at reducing the appearance of homelessness while being no better at actually solving homelessness itself. Someone sleeping outside of a homeless shelter isn't really any better than sleeping out on the streets. And that person may have been better off if the city had taken a housing-first strategy to rehousing. So what's the best way for cities to reduce homelessness? It's a housing-first strategy employed by government agencies and nonprofit organizations working closely to deliver services. Even as California recently increased its homeless population, the number of homeless people in the United States is down from its high in 2010. Cities in England and Germany have reduced its homeless populations thanks to a housing-first strategy and an emphasis on prevention. Salt Lake City in the U.S. was considered a national leader in homelessness. It reduced chronic homelessness by 91% between 2005 and 2015 using a housing-first strategy. Since 2015, however, the city has seen its homelessness rates rebound. High housing prices have meant more homeless people, and it has made it more expensive for the city to develop low-income housing for those who need it. These government agencies and nonprofits in California, Salt Lake City, and really everywhere need resources to succeed. One tangible thing you can do to solve homelessness is support local government candidates who believe in housing first policies and are willing to commit money to make it happen. With enough political will, we can reduce or even eliminate homelessness in our cities. Homelessness isn't a tricky issue. It's actually pretty straightforward. We just need to use tested solutions and dedicate the needed resources. So for a video like this, I'm scouring Google Scholar for papers on homelessness, using my university's library system, and logging onto newspaper and magazine websites for more of a current events look at the situation. For all of these things, I need the internet. I, like literally everyone watching this video, uses the internet. This video's sponsor, Dashlane, makes using the internet more convenient. Dashlane is a mobile and desktop app that does things like fill out forms with one-click logins and autofill your personal info. It saves your credit card so you can online shop without having to dig your card out of your wallet or purse. To put it in planning terms, it's like taking transit while everyone else is stuck in traffic. Dashlane doesn't loop you into a single system like Apple's Keychain. Dashlane is also super secure. Even they can't access your data. So go check out dashlane.com/citybeautiful to get a free 30-day trial of Dashlane Premium. You get the features I mentioned and more, like a VPN. It's a great deal. If you like it, you can use the coupon code CITYBEAUTIFUL at checkout for a 10% discount.